Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined on this edition with another new face in Scottish wrestling. He's the messenger of the Red Tree, is Redfield. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Billy.
I'm very excited for this one. You're a guy that I've seen around the Scottish wrestling scene on social media for a long time. So the fact that you actually have went and done the wrestling gives me a good excuse to get you on the show as well. So it's, I'm sure we've got plenty of work stories.
Like you said, I went to all the shows for years, really, as a fan, and I'm not getting any younger. So a couple of years ago, I just thought, why not? let's jump into it. Let's give it a go. Worst that can happen is it's not for me, but at least I can then walk away and say, well, you know what, I tried that. And that's something put to bed. But as it turns out, it's something I've had a lot of fun doing for the last 2 and a bit years. So still here, still at training whenever I can be, still, you know, just racking up the reps in the ring when I can.
We'll get back to that part of the journey, because we always go right back to the start when I get a guest on for the first time with the most cliche wrestling question in podcasting history. What got you into pro wrestling? So what was your first memories and what got you hooked on this weird sport?
Yeah, so the first match that I have a vague recollection of watching, it was Papa Shango versus someone. I want to say it was Hogan or something like that, right? And it was just like, I seen it on the TV. It must have been on TV at like a restaurant or like a Spoon's or something, wherever it was, knee high. I was just like captivated by it. And then we didn't have Sky or anything at that point at home, so never really got any more into it until maybe about 95, 96, which is when I came back round into it. And even then, like, I got into WWF for a bit, but I was really actually more into WCW around about that time. I used to stay at my gran's, who didn't have Sky Sports, but she did have Cartoon Network, which on Friday nights at 9 p.m. turned into TNT, which gave you Nitro and then Thunder afterwards as a double bill if you were caught in for punishment. My sort of earliest real memories of wrestling, of actively enjoying it, would be sort of WCW around about just before the rise of the NWO, to be honest.
It's weird.
Your sound went there. You're back. It's fine.
Sorry. This weird thing with the team. I think I just didn't have any wrestling friends when I was growing up, because everyone goes on about this the Cartoon Network over to TNT. I never even found out about this until like it was all dead and gone, and it was finished. And I missed out on all that. My WWF or watching was Channel 4 Heat.
Oh yeah,
that's all I got.
Well, you got Worldwide on Channel 5.
Yes, of course.
It was about 2 months behind. So at the rate they changed over titles in WCW, you'd be watching Hogan beat Macho Man for the title in '99. And it's like at that point, like Arquette was the champion or Russo was the champion. So it was a bit of a delay there. And that also had the really goofy thing where it would block the foreign object shots with like a big comedy Batman pow. WCW was my jam. I watched so much of it. And looking back, like I did, like when the network hit and we were getting all of that re-uploaded again, I was watching it back, going, how did I sit through like 3 hour WCW Nitros in '99? Some good matches on there, but oh my god, as a show, it was chaotic, man. It was chaotic.
Yeah, well, like you're saying, I got in for punishment, but yeah, that's the weird thing. Even now, going back, and I mean, I was quite lucky. I got right into the Attitude Era, and I love Ruthless Aggression. It's like a Reckless Intent. That's just my Scottish wrestling brain going. Ruthless Aggression and all that kind of stuff. So I was just all in, and I don't know how I stayed up for Raws and that, because I can't do that now. And I think about it now, I think, how did I do it then? Because pay-per-views, I'm just about managing. I mean, this is what, the week after Royal Rumble, so I'm still catching up on sleep, and we're recording on a Wednesday.
I can't do it. I just have to get my sleep and then stay off social media and watch it the next day. because I've tried it. Like, we tried to stay up. My partner is not a wrestling fan at all, but he will, like, he came to watch my first match, and obviously Drew was, you know, in the, he was challenging for the title at Mania, so I was like, oh, come on, we'll, like Scotland, you know, Scotland. So we got to about, you know, he opened the show obviously after the rain check there. We got to the end of that match, and I think we watched the Divas match afterwards. Sorry, no, Divas, they're not Divas anymore, are they?
The
Divas era's coming back. You know, that's Ashley Vega's gimmick, so I'll stay away from that. But yeah, we got through the women's tag battle royal, and we were just tired. Just too tired, like two men in their 30s that just cannot stay up past midnight anymore.
I've hung on. I mean, for yourself, you're actually maybe going to an office the next day, or actually going to a workplace with humans. I don't. This is my office, and this is where I work now. So I can just like wake up at 10 to 9 and plonk myself down here looking like utter shit, and it's absolutely fine. But no, the WrestleMania, that was particularly hard. I've never watched a show where I was hearing the birds chirp as I was going to bed, and I was like, this is the first time that's ever happened to me, and I don't like it.
I've had a few times with that, Lemania mostly, because those shows run long. They run too long for me now. I like that they're split over 2 days now.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's a thing they're going to continue. Because as much as I've fallen off watching WWE now, I still watch now and again. Like, I'll watch the Rumble, I'll watch Mania. You know, if I see, you know, someone like someone like Doudrop or Drew or Nikki or Kaylee Ray, you know, one of the homegrown lads or lasses that you root for, I'll make a point to try and watch their stuff. But I just can't do the live shows anymore unless I'm totally prepared for it and take a couple of days off, because otherwise I'm not going to be any use to anyone.
First year in a while that I've actually remembered to take the Monday after WrestleMania off, because I haven't in the past, and I've absolutely regretted it every time. But no, this isn't about just wrestling willy-nilly. This is your interview. I'm interviewing you, we're not just talking about what's going on in the world of other wrestling. So who were your favourites growing up then?
Favourites growing up, Sting. Firstly, like from, you know, Surfer Sting to, you know, Crow Sting to Joker Sting to, you know, even the Sting we've got now in AEW, where he still knows what to do. Like, if I'm moving like that at his age, doing like he's still like doing dives off stages. The guy's just, for me, is a complete package. So definitely Sting. DDP as well. Big Goldberg Mark as well, you know, all the big good guys. Like, I love Stone Cold, obviously, The Rock. Always had a soft spot for X-Pac as well. I couldn't understand why he was getting booed; it really upset me. But gravitated to guys like that. You know, it'd be easy for me to sit here and say, oh, you know, I love Dean Malenko, and I love Finlay and William Regal, and I do love them now, going back watching them, and I've got a better appreciation for what they do. But as a kid, I was drawn to, you know, like the big characters like Sting, DDP, love them.
My example for that exact point is I didn't get my first, like, one of my first tapes I got was that's VHS, kids, you had to rewind them yourself. Was Royal Rumble 94, and I started watching in 99, so this is a big difference. And I saw the Quebecers, that's who they were.
Yes.
And I thought, I don't like this, I don't like them. But I was like 13 at the time when I saw this. Mm-hmm. And then when I went back and watched, mainly through OSW Review primarily, went back and watched these, went, God, the Quebecers are amazing. They were just perfect. They did the Rougeaus as well. They did everything they needed to do spot on.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's growing up, like you're saying, at the time, big characters is what you're after. But now, suppose now you've watched enough wrestling, you can kind of dissect, and now that you're actually training to be a wrestler as well, you can appreciate all the little fundamentals, little movements, little here and there's.
There's more. It's kind of like I would imagine if you started studying, like my partner did film. at college. I forget exactly what it was, but it's like, you know, behind the sort of the camera style thing. And it sort of ruins movies for him now, because he's watching it being like, ah, they've done that. So it's the same when you're training and you see someone do something, you're like, oh, he's doing that because of that, and that makes sense because of that. So it does give you like an extra layer that you're watching it like that you didn't really think of before. And then there's the other party that's going, I could steal that. There's the difference in the wrestlers I like now and the difference is the wrestlers I liked when I was growing up or like night and day, apart from Sting. Sting's still number one. So
Sting stays. So you said that, like, round about the start of our chat there, that you finally got to a point of actually just going for it. So, well, again, rewind a little bit. How did you get introduced to the local wrestling scene then? So, because you were quite a few shows, Scottish, yeah, wrestling, yeah. I don't know, British, whatever, but how did you get introduced to the local scene?
So it was kind of weird, because I'd always liked, I was a bit of a sort of American indie, sort of, I guess you would have called me like a message board smark, I guess. So I saw that Colt Cabana was doing his Art of Wrestling in Edinburgh. Big Colt Cabana fan. And I seen that he was actually wrestling on a show afterwards in Edinburgh. So me and my partner at the time, we got tickets to go see Colt. And we were like, well, there's a show afterwards where we get to see him wrestle. Plus there's these guys that we've seen on, you know, on TV, you know, like Sagredo, Jester, etc. And, you know, everyone else that was on Fight Club. We just sort of went. We just really enjoyed the show. There was just some cracking matches on there. We had, I think the one that sold it for me, we had the Sumerian Death Squad versus Polo Promotions. And we were literally sitting there in this, you know, sweaty nightclub in Edinburgh that was packed, absolutely packed, with folk who were just so invested in what was going on in the ring. And we're like, how has this been on our doorstep? And we didn't realise that. So that's where I got introduced to, you know, the Polos, who quickly became one of my favourite, if not my favourite team. And, you know, Tommy End, obviously, who's, well, you see where he is right now, you know. So, yeah, from there it was like, right, well, and obviously they were promoting Fear and Loathing for there, so we went to that, and then it was just like every show we would get to, we were just there. We started branching out into, you know, like Source, Discovery, anywhere that, you know, we're like, well, I've got a day off, I've got a car, I'm just gonna go, you know. So that's that.
That's the thing. I think Colt Cabana's got a lot to blame to do with the actual boom in British wrestling, or certainly in Scotland anyway, because that exact point of I don't know if you're on UKFF or whatever other message board there was, again, something I literally discovered like way later than everything, all the controversy, way past all the tours and the Paul Nash and Waltman thing. Colt Cabana is really the kind of the guy that opened the gate for a lot of fans to go see Scottish wrestling. I mean, for myself, of course, I was more up north, so my first show was like Perth, and seeing, like, because Roddy Piper was there, I had to see Roddy Piper. As far as like you're saying, the American indie style, it was Colt Cabana. And like I say, it snowballed from there, and you went to see just about everything you get to. Any particular highlights, any particular moments that you had that maybe even in some way helped towards you actually going to try it yourself?
So I remember going to, the one thing I can think of is I went to Discovery Wrestling Show in sort of mid-2019. And just as a little bit of a backstory, when I first started going to shows, before I really started training, I was maybe between 7.5 and 8 stone. I wasn't a heavy guy. So in sort of 2018, I'd started properly working out, getting a proper regimen because I wasn't healthy and was trying to get, you know, a bit of meat on the old bones. And I went to, Joe Hendry used to do like a sort of live podcast. I don't know if he's, I'm assuming he doesn't do it in the COVID era, but he certainly used to. And that's when he announced that he was starting his own wrestling school. And he basically, he sort of put the question to everyone in the room that, you know, had thought about it, like, what have you got to lose, really? You know, the reasons that you are suggesting for not being able to do it, like, you know, there's a way around them. So for me, you know, I always thought, well, I'm too old now, I'm too small, that sort of thing. But looking on it, I thought, well, why not? And I then wind up not going with Joe's school for basically, it was based in Edinburgh, I'm based in Fife. Just couldn't wrangle them up with my work, basically. But then Andy opened up FBWA, and that's where I was like, oh, well, I can make it here. And, you know, and you know, Andy is one of the, he's been doing it for what, 15, 16 years now. He's one of the, like, the most accomplished technical wrestlers. They say heavyweight wrestlers, but he's one of the best sort of grapplers I've ever seen. And I don't know if he gets enough due for that because he's known as a powerhouse, I think. But the man's pure wrestling is second to none.
FPWA. So when you saw it was open, were you one of the first names in that first induction period, or did you hesitate a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. So it opened in October 2019, I believe it was. As soon as I seen there was a school in Fife that was sort of, it wasn't under the GPWA banner, but they were affiliated. And the quality of the coaches that, you know, they've got there, I was immediately interested. So emailed Andy, got the details, and it was, you know, there was a class, I don't know how many it was, maybe 20, 30, however many it was. And yeah, I was one of the first sort of intake there. I'm still there with a lot of the guys and girls as well.
It's like I say, Andy Wilde, of course, being his reputation is second to none, really, between the UK scene, NXT UK popping up there, and just being a widely respected wrestler. You also had Coach Stu,
who, absolutely.
If you're in Fife, then you probably would have seen Johnny Lyons a good few times for WPL or Discovery Wrestling, and just the intensity that is Johnny Lyons.
I've actually forgot a show that I went to first before I wound up going everywhere. I ended up going to an SWE show in Dundee. That was back in like 2010 or 2011, and Stu was actually on that show teaming with someone, it turns out. So yeah, like, Stu's enthusiasm is it's infectious. He's just, and he's so driven as well. He's just such a good coach. He's so patient. He knows what he wants you to take away from that, and he's very sort of good at getting that across, as is Andy. So
yeah. Doesn't mince his words, does Johnny Lyons. I'm getting, I guess, Coach Stu is exactly the same. I don't think there's much difference between
No, not at all.
So when you're saying you felt like you're too old, how many times did you get the old Batista did it this, DDP did it this? Did you get that quite often as reasonings?
Not really, because to be honest with you, usually when I tell people how old I am, they sort of do a double take and they're like, what? So, because I'm aware I'm sort of cursed with a baby face. It is reasonings I gave myself. Like, DDP was, I believe he was 3 years older than I am now when he started wrestling. I believe he didn't start till he was 38. So, you know, and look at how wildly successful he was, even, you know, away from wrestling. Even he's made his own his own empire, basically. Batista, same thing. Dude's, you know, he got into a bit older, but, you know, you can't deny the impact they had. Granted, there are some slight differences in my physique and Dave Batista's, ever so slightly. You know, there were guys who were older, and I think, especially if you're taking care of yourself, I feel like, you know, the whole, if you're in your 30s, you're too old for it. I feel like that is starting to end now, because you've got guys like AJ Styles, Finn Balor, who are, you know, they're sort of mid to late 30s as well, and you wouldn't accuse them of being too old, you know. So
it's sort of strange. I'm not saying that they're all like kind of older people, but I noticed like especially FPWA. Again, it's a lot more familiar faces that I've seen around
the
scene. So I'm just like, why didn't they try it before? Why didn't? And there's always a multitude of reasons. Was it? I think we already mentioned just the reputation Andy has, but was that your real kind of? It's Andy Wilde. I've at least got to give it one try.
Like, and I don't mean that as any sort of slight on Joe Hendry at all, because I would have been more than happy training under Joe, because Joe's a fantastic, accomplished wrestler, or even, you know, professional and amateur. But obviously, with, you know, everything lining up the way it did with FPWA being, you know, close to where I was working at the time, it was easier for me to sort of get there and work around my sort of work schedule, and then get home at a decent time to be back at work in the office for 9 o'clock the next day. So yeah, and then when I seen it was Andy, I was like, well, we know we're in safe hands. You know, it's not like this place has been opened up as a cash grab, and that because that's genuinely the furthest thing from Andy's mind. Everyone sees Andy Wilde, the sort of wrestler, the performer, who is phenomenal. But Andy, the coach, is one of the most patient and sort of friendly guys you could meet. And the knowledge that he brings as well, it's like no two training sessions are the same. Every week we're doing something totally different, something that maybe wouldn't have thought that I'd be able to do. But, you know, Andy and all the lads and lasses there are just so encouraging. It's just such a great atmosphere, to be honest. And it was definitely a factor in my decision to sort of go with Andy anyway.
So you started, said October 19-ish as when you made your start. What was that first session like? I mean, I'm assuming, again, from all past chats I've had, you're not in the ring your first day. It's kind of just your cardio, getting a feel for what it is. But what was the first couple sessions like?
Yeah, so I mean, obviously, it was fundamentals first, because there's no point sort of jumping into a ring and then trying like a hurricane rana. I'm saying hurricane rana like I've ever done a hurricane rana, but you know, I mean, there's no point trying something like that. It's very much fundamentals, rolls, bumps, being able to, you know, safely control yourself when you're falling, which is probably it's one of the most important things when you are wrestling that you've learned. And so between that, you know, your rules as well, just general body control, making sure that you can keep yourself safe, you know, when your body's moving. And then gradually, obviously, we were adding the other moving part, which was people into that, you know, other people, and working around that. So it was a slow build up, not that slow, because to be honest, we did pick it up not rapidly, but you know, we got there, and then we started, you know, like running a few drills with other people, and it's just building up your confidence to know that, you know, I know what I need to do here. I know the person I'm with there is going to be where I need them to be, that sort of thing. It was a bit daunting as far as cardio goes. Like, I've always considered myself quite fit. Like, I trained in taekwondo for about 20 years, there was quite a large break between me not training and starting at FPWA. So my cardio was okay, but it was not wrestling good. So I quickly learned that there's a difference between, you know, I can go for a run, no problem, and I can, you know, do a 2.5 hour wrestling training session. But that comes with reps, and that's why we're there, you know, 2-3 however many times a week, just to try and get your fitness up for that. And it's something that Andy's really good sort of instilling in us, that where our cardio needs to be.
Do you find that, like, as someone who's watched wrestling for so long, that you kind of had it in your head, oh, this is how it's done, this is the movement I need to make, and Andy would have turned to you and went, no, that's not how it's done, kind of thing? Was there anything like you thought, not that you thought you knew how to do it, but was there any like, I can do this?
So the only thing I can really think of with that is it's the way, like, little things like the way your body has to turn, the direction your body has to turn. There's a really good, you've probably seen it yourself, it was WWE Breaking Ground, it was, And there's this clip on it where William Regal chews them all out because they're stepping forward with the wrong foot. And it's like, maybe as a fan, you're sitting there watching, being like, well, why is he so insistent that it has to be that foot? And then but then when you're actually in training and it's explained to you, well, it needs to be this reason for this reason. And you go, ah, right, okay. Because I sort of went into it with the notion of like, I don't know anything. I'm green as goose shit, pardon the expression there. And if Andy says, you know, jump, it's like, well, how high, you know? So if he's telling me to do something, he's telling me to do something for a reason. So I'm gonna listen because I don't want to hurt myself, but more importantly, I don't want to hurt anyone else. So that's you just take everything that him, Stu, or whoever it is, because we've had a few sort of guests, and whoever it is telling us to sort of go, we do that.
So 5 months into training, you know, everything going well, getting everything you need to do. COVID.
Yeah.
COVID arrives. So that's this, you're already kind of on the back foot because, again, you think you're too old to start this, and now that you're getting time taken away from you, not because of anything you've done, it's not your fault. You weren't there biting bats, whatever happened to get to this point.
Yeah, yeah.
So was your initial thought, did you have any thoughts of, well, this is it, this is never going to happen? Or I suppose at that point, we didn't know how bad it was going to be.
Yeah, because we were taking it back. Because I was like, initially, like, oh, a month and we'll be fine. 2 months will be fine. And then by about sort of June, July, I was like, oh, this is serious. And this is where, like, we really have to give credit to Andy. I know a few of the guys you've had on from FBW have already sort of sung his praises this way, but Andy, Hannah, Stu, they organised sort of when we were supposed to be training, we would have a Zoom call, and it might have been like we were doing a sort of cardio workout as a class one day, or he would have, you know, we would be talking, you know, match structure or sort of looking over a match, or he would get someone like Sam Gradwell or Kings of the North or even, you know, Viper, Stevie Boy. He would get these, you know, really knowledgeable, really experienced, really talented, you know, wrestlers on to have a chat with us. Nick Aldis, even, how could I forget Nick Aldis? You'd have these guys on who and they were all so friendly, so, you know, open for questions. And Andy just was so good about, you know, sort of keeping us learning, even though we couldn't physically get in there. So it was a bit disheartening, you know, because you get that where you want to go to the gym or you want to, you know, roll around, grapple a bit, and you can't. All you can do is use the sort of the cheap weights that you bought off of some dodgy website, you know. It was a bit of a test. There was a bit of a, is the scene even going to need me? Like am I going to be sort of superfluous at that point? And I'm glad I didn't. I'm glad I stuck with it. I don't think there was any serious sort of ideas of quitting, but it was a bit of a, you know, for everyone, not just me. Like it's been a couple of dark years that we're slowly edging our way out of now, and it's just good to finally be back in there. And you know, we're not only training, but we had a whole showcase. So we did well.
We will get to the showcase. That was a guarantee for this interview. But we'll kind of. I try to keep it on a timeline order. I often tangent and just go wildly off it, but I'm getting better at actually just keeping a timeline of where we're at, just so it keeps everything right for people listening. Like I say, we could go to the next subject, right, and I could talk about TNA, would that be us for another half an hour or nothing? So Andy kept that routine. You still had your once a week or whatever, two times, three times a week, and you keep kind of active mentally, even though you couldn't really do much physically. Did you take your time? What else did you do? Did you take your time to revisit old shows that you'd watched again? Have that kind of extra layer now? Was there anything you kind of picked up again?
I actually fell out of love with wrestling a lot around about that time, to be honest. And I feel like I wasn't the only one to do that. And the sort of the pandemic era shows, they weren't, the performers were doing everything they could, and you can't fault them. Like, Big Drew carried a show with no crowd for a year. And I don't think he's got his flowers for that yet. And it's a damn shame, because that man did everything he could to keep a show interest and to be the face of a company, that a touring company that wasn't touring, and he was doing his absolute best to keep that going. But for me, I always feel like if I'm watching wrestling, I always need a crowd to be involved. I need a crowd to be reacting to what's going on. And there's just something fundamentally odd about watching a big spot to silence. It's so odd to me. So I fell out of love a wee bit. I took a step back, and I didn't completely stop watching, but I did sort of cut down what I was watching. And I did, I tried to go back and watch some of the matches that, like, really, like, you know, the matches that when you watch them, you get goosebumps and you start, like, even though you know the outcome, you're like, yeah. So, you know, stuff like Sting versus Vader, was one of my, I forget if it's the first or the second one. You know, Shawn Michaels versus Triple H for 2002 with Shawn's comeback match. That one just gets me going, like, gets me, like, marking out all the time. So it was more, yeah, it was more sort of revisiting what made me love wrestling in the first place, to try and get back in the headspace to be like, well, I need to really enjoy watching it, to enjoy doing it. And it took a while, but we got there eventually.
Yeah, I'm speaking of that kind of matches. Undertaker, Jeff Hardy, ladder match from Raw.
Oh, yeah.
That's always my go-to. If I'm thinking, I don't know what I want to watch, I'll put that on. Or a TLC or something, like, you know, Jeff, I'm a Hardy, big Hardy Boy fan. So that's,
oh, yeah,
that'll be,
oh,
why. Yeah. So, like I say, round about, during all this kind of stuff that was going on, yourself and Connie, I was spotted constantly on my Twitter, constantly talking about TNA. So I want to speak about how you got into TNA, what drew you to Total Nonstop Action Wrestling?
So, there is actually, I can remember the first time I seen this. Everyone's going to have to cast their minds back to, like, a time before internet, okay? Well, not before internet, but before you had all the information available at your fingertips the way you do now. So if someone disappears from the WWE now, you immediately know. Like, Shane McMahon has apparently left WWE. We probably knew about it before he did. So a guy would disappear from the WWE roster, and then maybe like 2 months later, you go, I wonder what happened to Road Dogg? Or, huh, what happened to Billy Gunn? So I was flicking through the channels one year, I believe it must have been like 2003 or something, and I found the wrestling channel, which had some really, like, sort of old WWF from the vault. It had old Japan stuff. It had ROH stuff, which was very interesting to me, because the very first Ring of Honor match I remember watching was AJ Styles versus the American Dragon, like, not Bryan Danielson, the American Dragon, which was, well, pardon the pun, phenomenal. But there was also something that they ran called TNA Classic. Now, TNA Classic was only 2002. It was only the year prior. But I remember watching it, and it was just this mad show where Vince Russo's coming out in army fatigues, kidnapping Jeff Jarrett. And I'm like, all right, okay. Okay, you've got me. Show me more. So I just sort of grew from there. It's just a company that I always followed. And as well as, you know, as well as the sort of the mad Vince Russo stuff, Sports Entertainment Extreme, you also had, you had guys like Styles, Daniels, Joe, Loki, Austin Aries initially, and then when they brought him back later, you know, these super Motor City Machine Guns, like these infinitely talented guys just doing these ridiculous, so, like, spots that still hold up to this day. Like, you go back and watch the Triple X versus was it America's Most Wanted, I want to say,
the cage,
yeah, the Six Sides of Steel. Like, that match still holds up. Like, the Elix Skipper off the top of the cage is unreal. So it was just that nice mix. And, you know, I did go back and I watched a 2002 NWA pay-per-view not too long ago, The first one, actually. And I was sort of cringing all the way through it, to be honest. It wasn't a great show. But it had that appeal. It was trying to be like, well, remember when wrestling was this? We're like that, but not quite as good. And also, we've got Jeff Jarrett and Scott Hall and Mr. Perfect. And I was like, all right, okay, cool.
Yeah, that Six Sides of Steel is, yeah, that was phenomenal. That was one of the few times I actually put down my money and bought it on DVD, because they had two disc DVDs. Yeah. And yeah. It's not in this house, it's at my folks, because they've got like a box of like 300 DVDs that I've just not taken into this house. But yeah, it was the bit of it fell in love. When we were speaking about the great names, of course, like likes of Pete Williams as well, Amazing Red. We could be here all day, yeah, just thinking the names. Above Average, Mike Sanders, you know, the best ones.
Apparently Mike Sanders, he's a party paramedic now. That's his gig.
So pays the bills. that's things you learn. This is not just an interview podcast, educational as well. So you mentioned all those guys, but you and Austin Aries come back to Austin Starr for the amazing paparazzi series that with Kevin Nash. And you're right, it's like going, I love the wrestling channel, I love the absolute madness of the advertisements for like Jushin Thunder Liger and
I remember they used to run like a 5 minute like no joke, a 5 minute like vignette for like as an advert for Curry Man.
Yeah,
didn't tell you where you could see him wrestle or anything like that. It was just 5 minutes of Curry Man doing his thing, and you're like, all right, okay.
Even better, it was just started with the "He's hot, he's spicy, tastes great." Curryman, and then just did his theme for that whole time. Yeah. And the whole time. And you just watch it going,
yeah, it was unreal.
Yeah. Team Shag be another big favorite.
Oh, yeah.
Adverts. Colt Cabana and Darren Burridge. I'm not going to Google it. I don't think my work's going to enjoy me Googling Team Shag.
Yeah, don't do that.
So TNA. Were you able to go back, and cause I know some of them have some of their pay-per-views on, or premium live events, whatever they're called now. They're on YouTube, because I remember going back and watching like Sacrifice and like say the first pay-per-views on there as well, with such classics as, yeah, did they have Little People on it?
Yeah, they had and this is his full name, who was Puppet the Psycho Dwarf.
That's it. Yeah.
R.I.P. Passed sadly last year. I was told, who, if I remember rightly, he was the one that pulled a gun on Jeff Jarrett. That was the angle. Jeff was making little person jokes at him, and Puppet pulled a gun on him.
Wrestling's amazing.
Yeah.
there's not enough guns in wrestling, I think.
I always flagged that as like, well, if it's no disqualification, you're in America. How hard is it to get a sidearm?
The fact that that's never happened in like WWE is shocking, considering all the some tasteless stuff they've put out over the years.
Yeah.
They've never had a gun.
The closest you've got is the whole Pillman Austin thing.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
and that's, yeah. I suppose, I think they got bitten with that, didn't they? So that's probably why they're going, cut that.
The old, was it, like, The Office US with Michael Scott, his improv classes. I don't know if you watch The Office US, but
I do, yeah.
Yeah, and he's his go-to thing in improv classes is having a gun. So you know, there's ways to get around it.
Yeah, it's just, Danny DeVito with his gun in Always Sunny. He's always got his piece, you know.
This is taking a turn. So we'll kind of move away from that. So outside of, we'll get to your first match, don't worry, we are going to talk about it, but I'm talking about what you're doing during lockdown instead. Sure. The other thing I noticed that you're quite into is your gaming. You're quite big into gaming as well. So yeah. What was your kind of first console? What was your first love? What's your jam?
So my first console I actually still own. It's in, I don't think it's in this room, it's in one of the other rooms, but it's a Commodore Amiga 500, which was my brother's console. My brother's not a gamer, but he had an Amiga, and I got it. So I had that, loved it. I had games like, I had Lemmings, the Robocop game, which I think is actually impossible to finish because of the way it's designed. Like, they don't, the time limit expires, and there's no way to actually beat it. Games like Worms, Desert Strike, you know, I think I had Cannon Fodder for it as well, Speedball Brutal Deluxe 2, games like that, brilliant. And I've basically, like, I've had a sort of, apart from my PS5, because I've still not been able to get one, but I've had a, like, a console every generation since, so moved on to SNES, big Mario fan, then jumped ship to the PlayStation, PS2, da-da-da-da-da. But I've basically filled out all the Nintendo consoles that I missed as I was going. So I don't think there's a Nintendo console I don't own, apart from a Virtual Boy, because I'm not made of money. But yeah, I remember I've got a really fond memory of getting a Super Nintendo. I've still got the box for it, even. Got a box Super Nintendo. That's like, it's like a Mario All-Stars theme, and I just remember, like, wasting so much time on that, just like being absolutely enamored. I was like, oh, games are never gonna look any better than this, man. Like, we like 6-7 year old me, whatever it was, just loving it. Yeah, that's what I did play when I was wee nipper.
I remember when you talk about, like, graphics and that, I remember when I grew up, I had a PlayStation and had Attitude. I didn't have Warzone, I had Attitude first of all. And I thought, oh my God, this is amazing. I'm going to get Smackdown. I got Smackdown, and I was blown away by the graphics. And I've still got Smackdown. I bought it again recently, put it in the PS3, turned on, and went, why did I think this was the best graphics ever?
It's like the sort of PlayStation N64 era is very polygonal. And it becomes very obvious when you go back and play them that this was their first time doing 3D modeling, wasn't it? So, you know, a lot of those games are very much of their time. And I feel like the games like Rayman, you know, the 2D side-scores, those are the ones from that era that sort of hold up the best. Although Mario 64, weirdly still, like, I think because of the sort of aesthetic of it, that, you know, that hides it a wee bit better. But yeah, my tastes have evolved somewhat. I've still got a Switch, I still play all that stuff when I've got a moment. I'm working my way through Super Metroid right now, for the first time. Never played it before, which is bizarre. But, you know, big Resident Evil fan, big Souls fan. I would say I'm a Silent Hill fan, but there's not ever going to be another Silent Hill, so whatever. Made peace with that now. Big horror fan. Playing a game right now, which I think it's still free on PS Plus for a few days, a game called Deep Rock Galactic, for anyone that's listening. It's fantastic. It's honestly, it's like 2 gigabytes, and it's a co-op game where you and you play a dwarf, a space dwarf, who's going to an alien planet, and you have to do, like, your mission is you mine, like, 200 this minerals, or you collect fossils, or you collect alien eggs, and the bugs that live on that planet are trying to kill you. And it's so simple, but it's so much fun. So there's a recommendation for anyone that's looking for something fun to play with some pals.
That's the thing, finding pals. I mean, I play Fortnite now, and I'd ended up, and I never wanted to play it. Started last year, if you asked me if I was playing it, I would have went, nah. And now here I am, plowing so much time into it. But, you know, it's finding, like, all these, like, things that come up, going, oh, do this with your friends. Like, I don't want to. Give me peace. I want to do it myself.
I do feel like sort of single player games are getting overlooked a little bit now, which is why when Resident Evil Village came out, I was so glad that it was just, you know, it was just a silly Resident Evil game, you know, with a, you know, like an 8-hour story mode or whatever it was. I was so happy to see that. But I think especially through, like, my partner's also a big gamer, and that's a lot of, especially over the pandemic, like, a lot of our, like, the times we spoke would be on PSN or you know, whilst we're playing, you know, Warframe, or, which is another one. Apparently I sunk 650 hours into that last year. I don't know how much of that was me, like, going away to do something else and leaving it running in the background, or and how much of that was me just trying to grind out one particular item. But it does help when you've got someone, you know, like that you're particularly close to, and that's one of their big interests as well. So, yeah.
I don't feel particularly bad about my 572 hours on Fortnite now, just after hearing that. But again, I'm thinking the same thing. It's, I don't think it's just all me playing. I think idleness is quite a lot of it. Just like starting up and then coming out, and it still whirs in the background on the PS4. So
yeah, because there's so many times like we just forget about the game and just be chatting away about nonsense, and then it'd be 2 hours later and be like, oh right, yeah, we've got a mission to do. Yeah, so there's a lot of that in it, but we did play a lot of it, like, so I'm not making excuses, like, especially like when there was nothing else to do, like we just played so much of that game.
But no, you did mention, yeah, your tastes have changed. So yeah, Mario and Resident Evil, quite a bit different.
Yeah, I'm just waiting for the crossover.
Yeah, I mean, nowadays, who knows? It could happen. I'm not big into like Resident Evil franchise at all. So I could make a joke here, but I have no idea where I'd go with it. I wouldn't even know where to start. I don't know if they collect stars in Resident Evil.
Yeah, no, the best thing to do to sort of give you a beginner's guide to making Resident Evil jokes is you can find a super cut of the bad cutscenes from the original PS1 game, where they're, number one, they're terribly acted, and number two, some of them are live action. So they actually had people dressed up like, you know, as Chris Redfield, as Wesker, as Jill. And oh boy, these actors, they tried. I'm not sure I could have done a better job, so I just want to preface it with that. But oh boy, that, like, it became a bit legendary. The voice acting in that game is special.
They made the choice, and
they did.
Right, let's speak about the first match then, because okay. I've teased people long enough that have gone through this, and we haven't spoken about enough about Joker's thing to really. But anyway, we'll get into the first match. I think that's what people are going to be listening for. The showcase was supposed to happen before the pandemic. I can't remember when. I did have it written down somewhere, but then it was May at some point. Got cancelled, of course, for obvious reasons. And then, of course, we got into 2020. What year is it? 2021. That's the year. And showcase is coming. It wasn't really announced. I don't know if it was just in case it didn't happen. I didn't really want to put people's hopes up so much. But it happened. When did you find out that you were going to be actually getting to wrestle in front of people?
So I'd been, due to the nature of the job that I'm currently doing, I hadn't been at training as regular as I would have liked. I was doing a lot more sort of one-to-one coaching with Andy, a couple of folk, if they had a morning off, they would come and, you know, give me someone to sort of grapple with. And then I think it was maybe about a month out, Andy was like, oh yeah, we're putting a showcase on. I was like, all right, cool. And he's like, yeah, so we've got you in a tag match. I was like, oh, okay, cool. So it was kind of a sort of casually out of the blue. And I was like, right, okay. So it wasn't a lot of preparation. It was literally like a month out, I would say, at most, where we found out that we were going live.
And what did you have gear prepared, or was it a month out you're thinking?
Oh, no, I'd already gotten gear, purely because I just wanted to be prepared. So I had a little bit of gear. Not fully there yet. It's not fully what I want it to be yet, but I had a pair of wrestling trunks that I could wear. So from there, it was just more like what I was interested in was, like, number one, who am I tying with? But then number two, who are we going against? And that chopped and changed a lot, because there was, in December, there was a lot of COVID issues going around, people taking precautions, people unfortunately suffering from it. So the card got changed around a lot. And it wound up being Mr. Berry, who stepped in to be my partner, and we were teaming up against Maverick. It was supposed to be just us 2-on-1 against him. And then he cheated and he was allowed to get another partner, which I didn't sign on for, but you know, he got Brent and Brent did a admirable job of, attempting to stop us. Didn't work. Fair play to him. He'll probably have some excuse, but
I think I'm due to have him in a few episodes time, so I'll find out his thoughts on that.
What a treat. It says a lot that we beat him so bad that he left the country for a bit. It was something like I was equal parts really looking forward to it and equal parts like really nervous, even though I know, it wasn't the largest crowd and a lot of it was people that we knew, so it was like a safe environment. There's still that part of me like, I'm gonna tag in and then I'm gonna fall flat on my face and everyone's gonna laugh, and then Nelson Muntz from The Simpsons is gonna appear and laugh at me, and then I'm just gonna disappear forever right off in the sunset. But so there's a lot of conflicting emotions going around there.
Before we talk about how you felt about the actual match itself, Redfield. So I think you've already told me how it's from, just from your chat about Resident Evil. Yeah. So is there a particular reason why you picked Redfield in particularly?
Yeah, so I was toying about with some names, like I was mixing names up. But the problem is they all just sounded, they were either kind of taken already or they just sounded like a lad that works, in a regular job. So I was taking like Silent Hill protagonists and then I was like, you know what, we'll do a share. We'll just have them on in them. And that'll do me. And I picked that because the Redfields are the sort of the icons of Resident Evil, Chris in particular, who, if you look at the designs for Chris over the last sort of every game he's been in, he starts off as like just, sort of average sized dude. To be like the Resident Evil 5 version of Chris Redfield is literally Brock Lesnar with a different haircut. Then they slimmed him down again for 7, changed his voice actor, changed his hair color, everything, and then he was back to normal for Resident Evil 8. No explanation, but I just felt a character with that sort of evolutionary journey. I was just really drawn to the name, and I was just like, it was the one I was like, that sounds most right to me. Out of all of them.
I think I've already spoke about it with Craig Berry, but it just means that your team was the Red Berries, which I enjoyed that.
Yeah.
I mean, you catch me with a pun, then I'm going to be a fan for a very long time. So what was behind the Redfield loves you stuff then? Again, is this Resi stuff that I have no idea about? Where did
you... So I'm a big... sort of fan's the wrong word, but I'm very, very interested in conspiracy thought, modern conspiracy thought, and the modern conspiracy theorists, and how that has all evolved from. So you could argue that sort of modern conspiracy, and this is going to be a tangent, but I'll try and keep it as brief as I can. So modern conspiracy thought, sort of for me, originates around about the time that JFK was assassinated, which is why a lot of the sort of the comments I make as a character reference that. Because just to compare two things, we've got the president who was shot in broad daylight and a busy, busy city, and we have, maybe two or three pictures of it, one video of it, but no one can agree what happened. No one knows what happened. And then you compare that to and this is going to be really heavy, but you compare that to what I would say would be the other big American tragedy of the last sort of 100 years, which would be the, September 11th, 2001, where we have as many camera angles as you want. If you wanted, if you were inclined, you could go and see that happen from, every side of the towers if you wanted. If there's no information about that visually on the day that you can't see. And again, we can't agree what happened. I mean, most people can. Most people know exactly what happened, which is, you know, two planes hit the building. But there will be people, there are genuinely people who sit out there and go, well, no, that was a hologram. Or, no, no, the plane was a decoy. There was actually, you know, and you go down that well. And I think the way these people get so convinced of their ideas, and they move the goalposts all the time. They say one thing, you say, well, no, that's that because that. Then it becomes, ah, no, but that proves that because this. And I just think the idea of someone who is constantly, you know, changing the goalposts like that, it's infuriating to watch because you're not listening. So I coupled that with something else I'm really interested in, which is, it kind of goes hand in hand with it, especially with QAnon right now, which is the formation of cults and cult leaders. And the whole Love You thing came from, there was a cult called Love Has One Equals Heart, where the girl that ran that was basically like a soccer mom, and it was a whole like self, you know, we just love everyone, you know, we just love everyone, we love their money that they're giving us, but we love everyone, you know. And she actually she died because she took a lot of colloidal silver to prevent against COVID, which didn't work for some reason.
They prevented COVID.
Well, yeah, that's true. So for me, it was just, it's trying to mesh those sort of themes together of, you know, because I always said, like the idea of Alex Jones going crazy about frogs being gay is hilarious to me. The actual mindset behind it and why he does it, less so. But, you know, that clip of him losing his marbles over frogs is just, like, everyone knows what that is. And I just wanted to try and marry up the idea of, you know, doing this without, you know, the sort of the right wing, you know, connotations, and just try and make someone who will literally be like, you know, we were having a, you know, there's a conspiracy theory about this. I did a promo sort of last minute to promote the you know, the showcase, where I sort of suggested that the COVID pandemic was engineered to stop me from debuting, that sort of thing. You know, someone who says something so outlandish that you can't argue with it. But so that's
the sort of they say with such confidence and conviction that there's no point in arguing with it, because it's the Roddy Piper just when you've got the answers, I change the question.
Yeah, you just change the goalpost, or like McCarthyism, where, you know, you just tell a lie and you tell it, you know, bit, like loud enough and often enough that people start to believe it, or always do start to believe it. So that was the sort of origins of that. We had a promo contest. We had two promo contests actually. Whilst we were in lockdown, that's something else Andy did with us. I think I know Craig mentioned that as well.
Yeah, when he shot himself at Comic Con. Yeah.
that's where the whole idea came from. I was just toying around with ideas, and that's where like the whole Redfield Love You thing came from. And it was just one of those things where like I said it and everyone seemed to like it, and I was like, well, that's that sorted, you know. So there we go.
That's your first merch and down the line as well. Excellent. Right, let's talk about the match then, because again, I reeled people in and then threw them out with conspiracy theories, which you did say you'd speak about, because when you quote tweeted the question thing.
I did, and my partner would be very, just to show like the sort of frequency which I do talk about these things. I was running my mum and dad up to Aberdeen for some reason or the other. I think they have family up there, so they were wanting to see them for some reason. And I jokingly said, oh, but don't worry, I've prepared, like, I've got five podcasts here all about the JFK assassination. And they just sort of did that whole, like, okay, like, they sort of resigned, oh, God. And then I was like, I'm joking. But the idea that they thought I would actually make them do that is, you know, apparently not that far from the, you know, from reality, apparently. So, just don't get me started on that stuff. I will not stop.
We'll get into another time, I'm sure. But yeah, the match itself then. So as you said, Redfield, Big Berry, and you defeated Maverick and Brink Carter as well.
Yeah.
What were your initial thoughts of the match, as enduring, or after, were you quite happy you didn't fall on your face when you got into
like in all honesty, I was just happy to get through it without basically to get through it, really, is the best way I can put it. You know, me, Brent, Craig, Mav, like, we were all, I believe, in that initial intake in 2019. So it was nice in a way there. It, you know, we've all trained together. We all trust each other. So we knew what we were doing. We knew what we wanted to achieve. And looking back on it, you know, we all did what we wanted to do, and we all did it well. So it was it was nerve wracking, but then watching it back, it was, you know, it hit the way we wanted it to hit. So.
So now you've got the taste for actual being in front of a crowd. It was, I hear from a lot of people that when you go out, as soon as you go out, you can either just switch it on, and that's you. You're ready to interact with the crowd, whether you need to or not. Did you feel that, or do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I was very much like, sort of, you know, I think Craig mentioned this as well. There were kids in the front row who really hated him. Beside me as well. I don't think they hated me. I don't think anyone can hate me. But they were giving it to us pretty tight. And you know, even though there wasn't a lot of them, you know, it was just nice getting the sort of desired reaction. You don't really think about what's happening. You just sort of, you do go into a wee bit of autopilot, and you do sort of take over. You know, all the worry does sort of go, and the sort of adrenaline kicks in, and you're like, right, okay, well, this is happening now, and you just go with it, really.
So one match, and then of course I'm assuming you're not in going right, put my CV to all the promoters now. I've done my one match. I'm ready to go. But is there anywhere that you want to get to in the near future?
Yeah. So there's, I mean, the one thing that Andy is. One of the things that Andy has been really good at, because he's been really good with us in a lot of ways, is putting us in touch with different you know, promoters. So I've crewed at Discovery before. I helped build the ring, build a steel cage there once. It's honestly been one of my favorite promotions for a few years now. I think Alan does a tremendous job. He gives people a chance as well. That's something I've noticed. He will take a chance on someone if he personally sees something in them. So, like, even, you know, he was bringing up guys like Chris Ridgway. I think he was one of the first bookers in Scotland to bring him up. Ridgway might have been an ICW first, I'm not sure, but he was definitely in Disco. Guys like Gene Money, I think the only place you would have seen him really regularly up here, Discovery. Martino. So he does that. He'll bring in people that he sort of trusts. And he'll use them, but he also has he's not afraid to bring in the Elite, or I think he's got Mark Haskins even coming soon, guys like that. So it's a good mix. It is a really good mix. And I'd say if I had one goal, it would be I'd want to follow in the footsteps of we had Tommy Cartel, Beth Shorty, and Frank Gallo. They were on a pre-show for Discovery. That would probably be my sort of, that's my sort of short to mid-term goal, is to be in a stage where I'm at least being considered to do something like that.
What would be the dream opponent then? Again, this is, we'll do a big fantasy WrestleMania main event question to finish up, but who would be guys you'd immediately want to get in the ring with? I'm assuming Andy, of course, would be.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Andy would be safe as houses. A guy that I have a lot of respect for, and who I think I would work really well with, would be a guy like Caleb Valhalla. He's a little bit smaller than me, but it would be okay. Caleb would be good. A guy like Talon Jr. is a tremendous talent. I'm going to throw a curveball, actually, and I'm going to suggest... people that I would actually like to wrestle. I'm going to throw a little bit of a go outside the box event. I'd also say, purely because I've trained with her, Harmony Sky is another phenomenal young talent. Sky is the limit. There's a pun for you, for her. But yeah, no, she's tremendous. We've trained together a lot, and we'll throw Ashley Vega's name out there because I've got a lot of respect, and Jason Reed as well, actually. So there we go. There's
good handful to get you going.
Yeah, guys and girls that I feel like I would at least be able to, you know, hide my creaking bones and make me look like a professional wrestler, you know.
Harmony Sky, of course, I've spoken to her twice now on this podcast, and we plan to try and make it an annual thing. We'll do a wee catch up and see how she's getting on. Sure. And the difference in 12 months is ridiculous. Yeah. Between her making her act, because I think spoke to her because I was just not told to, but had that many recommendations to get her on. She hadn't even debuted.
Yeah.
I thought, I'm going to have to speak to her. And she was great, really nice, really timid. And then a year later, we spoke to her again. She made her debut. She'd been wrestling everywhere. And this person was just 100% different. Same with Ashley Vega. It's really nice to get, and as well as Craig, getting all these guys on from right around the start when I'd started the podcast and listening, getting them on again and going, Jesus, this is amazing.
The sort of the growth of Harmony into, you know, as a person as well as a wrestler has been wonderful to see. She actually won, well, I mentioned promo tournaments before, she won the first one, and it's like, not that we didn't think she was capable, but the promos that she was cutting like came out of absolute nowhere. It came out of left field for me, because we knew she fantastic in the ring, but then she started to translate that into the character as well, and I think she's a name that we're going to be hearing a lot more of. I'd be very shocked if we weren't, because there's just so many names like that in FPW. I've mentioned some of them, but you've got Ross Hunter and Robbie Balfour as well. They're making a name for themselves now. Two young lads who are extremely talented. I've mentioned Talon Jr. I've mentioned Caleb as well. Like, Caleb was a name obviously before he started training with us, but the amount of people that are coming through FBWA, and they're maybe on their way, but then they're training with Andy, they're training with Stu, they're training with, you know, guys like Jason Reed, guys like Talon, and it's honing them, it's making them better versions of themselves. I'd say everyone that's walked through that doors is, you know, a better version of themselves than they were before they started training.
Yeah, that seems, yeah, just to round off the some of the rough edges as well a little bit.
Yeah,
like you're saying, like a Caleb came from WrestleZone originally, and there you go, everyone. There's your WrestleZone mention in the podcast. And you got guys that came from W3L as well and came with Stu. So, it seems to be a nice way. And, of course, Andy's he's now got in with NXT UK. He can bring back what he learned. So it's
absolutely
it's a really great place to kind of finish all that off and get you all ready for the big wide world of pro wrestling.
Yeah, absolutely.
We'll ask her stupid questions because we always do. So the first question we ask everyone is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Okay, well, this is where I try and not go off on a tangent, because I actually have a Bachelor of Science with honors in zoology.
There we go. We've got a professional on podcast so, last.
I think it was either second or third year, I wrote an answer for an exam that wound up being about 10 pages long on the difference between bird-hipped and lizard-hipped dinosaurs. So I would have to say, on the basis of that, in my professional opinion, an ankylosaur is probably my favourite, because, you know, taking that thing down, like, it's literally just a suit of armour. Like, it's hardy.
The one looks like an armadillo kind of thing.
Yeah, and it's got like a tail with like a basically a mace on the end of it. Like it's unreal. That's my favorite.
That's fine. We've got also our question we ask is, what would win the fight, two sheep or one cow?
How big are the sheep and how big are the cows?
See, right, okay. I think it's the first time I've had to do it this season. That's the question. You can use your imagination any way you wish after that.
Right, okay. Because you've got to imagine, sheep aren't going to do a lot of DPS and a cow would trample them. So unless the sheep are like genetically engineered to be bigger somehow, the cow wins that fight 9 times out of 10. So yeah, cow.
Analytical, logical. That's fine. I'm not going to argue with that at all. I'm still after coming up to 2 years now of asking this question, I'm still believing in the two sheep. I think it's just in my heart. I think it's maybe because I'm too close to Aberdeen.
I mean, there's so many variables there. Not to turn it into Jordan B. Peterson, but what is a cow? What is a sheep? How do we measure what a sheep is? But
you're only the second person to really call out this question. The first was Joe Hendry.
That's a esteemed company I find myself in. I'm not arguing with that.
No, he didn't. I don't think he answered the question because he kept asking additional questions with it.
Brilliant.
I don't have any more information. This is the info. I think, yeah, time. I didn't realize that we'd chatted so long. And like I say, we've only got so many mentions of Joker's thing in this particular episode. But before we kind of wrap up, then we'll ask the last question I'm trying to get as our last question, even though I'm 10 episodes in. I think I've only done it maybe 4 times. Fantasy match. So your career, however it's gone, Vince McMahon, he's still alive. He's 140. He's called up and he's given you the main event of WrestleMania or whatever the big show is. He's bought AEW, could be Revolution, All In, whatever. You get to pick your opponent or opponents and the match of your choosing. What is it?
So I have to defer to Biggie Langston on this one. I've got to sort of think, well, what do people want to see from a WrestleMania main event? Okay. And what they want to see is, to quote Biggie, big meaty men slapping meat. So I'm gonna take that match that he wants. He wants Biggie versus Goldberg. I'm gonna throw me in there as, you know, much larger individual as well. And there we go, triple threat for whatever the main title is now. I genuinely have no idea.
You're the filling to this meaty sandwich.
Yeah. We'll go with that.
That's the point we're ending on. I think that's a good one.
We're anywhere from there.
No, don't think we can. So thank you very much for joining me today. Where can people find out about Redfield on social media?
So my Twitter and my Instagram is both at Redfield FPWA. I don't have much else, to be honest with you, social media wise. I don't have Facebook. I don't have the TikTok. I don't have Bebo or MySpace or whatever social media is in right now. I did a sort of big cleanse not too long ago. Well, probably a while ago now, but I've basically got those two accounts and that's it. So at Redfield FBWA. And also just to plug it here as well, if anyone listening isn't, you know, training and is interested in the Fife area, I can't recommend FBWA enough. Andy, Stu, Hannah, they're so welcoming. You know, Andy does individual classes as well. Just, you know, one-on-one classes or group classes, and there's an all-females only class that he does every month. So if it is something that you've ever considered, it's such a great atmosphere, and I'd highly recommend anyone even thinking about it, just try it. You've not really got anything to lose. So you can find them, I think they're just FPW Asylum, I think it is, on Twitter and Instagram. You'll find them. We retweet them all the time. You'll find them.
Perfect. Well, again, thank you very much for taking the time to speak with me today.
No, thank you for having me on, man. You have a pleasant evening. And Redfield loves you.